I think, computation is fundamental both in applied context, but also to understand the world we are living in. Computation happens in computers, it happens in biology, it happens in the universe. So I think to understand the fundamental questions of computation is like one of the most interesting questions today.
This is Professor Ola Svensson of the IC School at EPFL, and to illustrate this intimate connection between the theory of computation and of physical reality, let's discuss the infamous P versus NP problem.
So this, roughly speaking, is the question about, is it easier to verify a solution than to find a solution? So most people would think that it's easier to verify a solution. So think of Sudoku, for example. Here, if someone is given a solution with numbers to you, it's easy to verify that this is a correct solution, but it might be very hard to find one. So one of the most pressing questions in computer science is whether this is indeed the case, that it's harder to find a solution than verifying it. And we don't know.
In fact, there is a $1 million prize at stake here, since the P versus NP problem is one of the 7 Millennium Prize problems of the Clay Mathematics Institute. It's also likely to be the one which may potentially have the greatest impacts on our daily lives, or at least on my everyday life.
For example, if you would prove that it's as easy to find a solution as to verify a solution, then you could automatize the work of a mathematician. Because often you see the proofs that we have are easy to verify once you have them, but we think they are hard to find. But if we could prove that there is some method that makes it easy to also find them, then we could just find all the proofs that are available in an easy way.
But the implications would not be restricted to my personal daily life.
Also, it would have enormous impact on optimization, logistics. All these problems are seen to be hard to solve, but such a result would that it's as easy to find solutions to verify would then yield like very fast algorithms for complex problems.
Let's dig a little bit deeper here. When Ola Svensson is talking about the easiness or the hardness of a problem, he's actually talking about the computation time needed to solve the problem. Verifying the validity of a Sudoku grid is easy in this sense because there is a basic algorithm that quickly checks whether the Sudoku grid was indeed valid. However, it seems that algorithms need much, much, much more time to solve a Sudoku than to check the validity of a finished grid. But it's still not clear what we really mean by quickly or by much more time. We need a more quantitative measure of computation time. Now, if we were doing experimental computer science, then we might want to run an experiment and to use a chronometer watch. However,
it's not so good to compare different algorithms from different time eras. When you have a faster computer, your algorithm would automatically run faster. So what we do instead is to compare algorithms in the number of steps they perform, because the time it takes to perform a step is faster tomorrow in a newer computer. So it makes more sense than to compare with something that is invariant with the current with the laptop you actually run it on.
Fortunately, as we discussed it in a previous video, in 1936, Alan Turing came up with a brilliant model of all computers, both past computers and future computers all at once. This model is called the Turing machine, and there's a very natural notion of computation time that's associated with this Turing machine, namely the number of operations performed by the Turing machine. It is in terms of this number of operations that the computation time of algorithms is measured in computational complexity theory. Now, that's not the end of the story.
In the theoretical computer science, we are usually worrying about the asymptotic behavior, which means that how well does the running time scale as a function of the size of the problem. If you're given a Sudoku of small size, you would expect to be able to find a solution faster than if it's a big Sudoku.
This is the fundamental concept of scalability. The trouble with a lot of prototypes is that they are usually tested on small samples of the real deal. However, some algorithms perform very well on small data sets, but extremely poorly on big data. Asymptotic analysis is a wonderfully powerful way to foresee as much as possible the behavior of our algorithms on big data without having to test the prototypes on big data?
So let's say you want to sort n numbers. There are many different sorting algorithms. Some of the most basic sorting algorithms runs in something called quadratic time, so n squared time. So that means if I have 10 numbers, I would need roughly 100 operations. If I have 1,000 numbers, I would need 1 million operations. Okay, which then is a quadratic increase in number of operations as the number of numbers I want to sort. This turns out to be quite expensive computationally if I want to sort huge numbers, huge database of numbers.
Yes, because these days databases can have billions, if not trillions, of entries. Now, with an n squared complexity, the number of operations required to sort such databases will be about a billion squared. Yet today's computers typically run at a few gigahertz, which corresponds to a few billion operations per second. And this means that to sort a billion numbers would still take a few billion seconds. Now, a billion seconds, that's 32 years. You don't want to wait that long.
Whereas if I have the best sorting algorithms, so sometimes they have a running time n log n, which is almost linear in the number of numbers. So if I have 10 numbers, this would basically be 10 operations. If I have 100 numbers, it will be roughly 100 operations. 1,000 numbers, roughly 1,000 operations. And 1 million operations have roughly 1 million operations.
And if you had to sort a billion numbers with the n log n algorithm, it would basically take us a few billion operations to do so. And this can be done with today's computers in a second or so. That's much better than 32 years, right? Now that you hopefully better understand some of the basics of complexity theory, let's get back to the P versus NP problem, and let's define P.
It's a class of problems that has a polynomial time algorithm, and that scales polynomially in the size of the input.
So a problem is in P if there is an algorithm that solves all instances of the problem and whose computation time is no more than n to the power something, where n is the number of bits used to describe the instance of the problem. On the other hand,
NP is then a class of problems for which you can verify the solution in polynomial time. So given, if you give me the solution to the problem, at least I can check, there is an algorithm that checks in polynomial time that it is a solution.
So a problem is in NP if there exists a verifier algorithm that, given any instance of the problem and any potential solution to the problem, determines in polynomial time whether X is indeed a solution to this instance of the problem. A common misconception of NP is that it is a measure of hardness. It's not. NP is a measure of easiness. A problem that is not in NP is a problem that is very, very, very hard. Conversely, a problem that is in NP is so easy that it allows for the existence of a polynomial time verifier algorithm. And thus, the P versus NP problem asks whether problems for which there exists a polynomial time verifier also have a polynomial time solver. If this is the case, then this would mean that P is equal to NP. In any case, you can see that we strongly insist on the notion of polynomial time computation.
Polynomial time is, as historical, be defined as efficient, and it turns out that that also corresponds very well what is efficient in practice. So of course, if you have a algorithm that runs in n to the power of 100, so it's not very practical, but often such algorithms have been shown to be running in quadratic time or linear time with further research. So it's very few problems we have that we have like an n to the power of 100 time algorithm, but we don't have any better polynomial time algorithm. So it has seemed to be corresponding very well with practice.
Now, how can we prove that P is equal to NP? Well, one major step towards an understanding of P versus NP was the characterization of the so-called NP-complete class.
NP-complete, that's an amazing definition or class of problems, in the sense that we have many problems in NP that we do not know how to solve efficiently. So we don't have polynomial time algorithm. So we have many, many open questions can this problem be solved in polynomial time or not? So the class of NP-complete problems that reduces all these open questions to one problem. Namely, if we can solve one of these problems, then we can solve all of them. So this shows that all the NP-complete problems, they're equivalent when it comes to efficient algorithms.
In other words, the NP-complete problems are sort of the hardest of the class NP. In particular, it suffices to solve one NP-complete problem in polynomial time to prove that P is equal to NP. On the other hand, to prove that P is different from NP, the easiest way to go would probably be to prove that one of these NP-complete problems is indeed very hard and cannot be solved in polynomial time. In any case, the P versus NP problem naturally leads to a focus on NP-complete problems. And now, I'm sure you're dying to know some of these NP-complete problems.
Maybe the most famous example is the traveling salesman problem, which is the problem of you want to visit N cities, find the shortest way of visiting these cities.
Another example is Sudoku, but not this one right here. Recall that we're interested in the asymptotic analysis. That is, we're really wondering about how hard Sudokus get when they become larger and larger. Now, if you find a clever way to solve larger and larger problems of Sudokus, then you might be on the right track to prove that P is equal to NP. But beware of how computer scientists feel about P equals to NP.
I don't think so. The majority don't think so. And the reason we don't think so, I think, is mainly because of the intuition I said before, that it's easier to verify a solution than finding one. Okay. We don't know, of course, this is far away from being known at the moment, but it seems very strange that if that's true. There are also, of course, people have tried to find efficient algorithms for these problems for 50 years without managing to do so, but that's little evidence.
Another reason why computer scientists do not believe in P equals to NP is that the consequences would be dramatic.
That would mean that you could automatize the work of a mathematician, basically. You could, the crypto that we use today would be useless, and you could solve optimization problems like in logistics, in airplane scheduling, to optimality very efficiently. So this would have great consequences.
Okay, but what about if we get to prove that P is different from NP?
So since most people believe in that, our world has been built assuming that this is the case. So I think that would probably not have the same consequences as a proof that P is equal to NP.
It almost sounds like proving that P is different from NP would not be such a big deal.
No, proof would be need to be like earth-shattering. We are not close to prove anything like that.
In fact, amusingly, in 2010, when Vinay Deolalikar of HP Labs posted a 100-page proof that P is different from NP, complexity theorist Scott Aaronson was so confident that we were still very far from a proof of that, that despite judging the manuscript as well-written, competent, and promising, and despite having only had a superficial read of the manuscript, Aaronson nevertheless boldly declared that he would give a supplement of $200,000 to Deolalikar if his proof checks out. Unfortunately for Deolalikar, it didn't, and Aaronson hasn't become poor. The bottom line is that the P versus NP problem is notoriously very, very, very tricky, and subtle errors are likely to lie in the details.
So we are super far away from proving anything of that type.
Proving that P is different from NP might not fundamentally change the world we live in. However, it might lead the way to finally proving that some cryptographic systems are really secure.
So right now, we do not have very good tools to prove that there exists no algorithms for doing this task. This would be of intrinsic importance for crypto. Can I prove that there exists no good algorithm for a certain problem? Then we have a provable crypto system.
Now, beyond application considerations, the P versus NP problem is also very exciting to me because it seems that it might be having strong implications to physics and to the nature of space and time. In particular, some computer scientists have postulated the so-called extended Church-Turing thesis as a fundamental law of our universe.
Yeah, so that's the thesis, that a Turing machine can efficiently simulate any other computation.
In particular, as opposed to the weaker classical Church-Turing thesis, the extended Church-Turing thesis postulates that the number of operations required to perform a computation on a Turing machine is the right measure of computation time on all computation machines.
I think it's much more unclear than the Church-Turing hypothesis that everything can be computed by a Turing machine. So at the moment, there are problems that can be computed much faster by a quantum computer than a traditional computer. We don't know if that is because we have not been able to come up with a fast algorithm for a traditional computer yet, or whether there is a real difference in the power of these computational models. So one such example is factoring, where the best traditional algorithm has exponential running time, or something like 2 to the power third root of n, whereas a quantum computer has a polynomial running time.
The class of problems that quantum computers can solve in polynomial time is called BQP. Now, BQP contains P, which corresponds to saying that quantum computers can do at least as much as classical computers. Now, what Ola Svensson just said is that we don't actually know whether BQP is strictly larger than P. Another thing we do not know is whether BQP is as large as NP. Can quantum computers solve all NP problems?
So today there is no evidence that that should be the case. And I don't believe so. I think most people don't believe so. There are problems for which there are provable improvements by quantum algorithms. Suppose you want to search in n numbers, then a traditional, you want to find a minimum, let's say, you want to find a minimum of n numbers. A traditional computer needs to inspect every number to find a minimum. That takes n time, whereas a quantum computer can do it in square root of n time. It's very impressive. But there is no evidence that it should be able to solve an NP-hard problems efficiently.
To me, the amazing thing about this whole complexity zoo is that we're talking literally about what can be computed in a given amount of space and time. We're not just looking at the nature of computation here, we're looking at the nature of space and time themselves. This mess of computational complexity classes, I think, ultimately has implications for physics and biology and for our basic understanding of everything.
Alan Turing invented a machine much, much, much simpler than the machines that the others were inventing, but the machine of Turing was so simple that it was universal.